Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. We have a wonderful program here for you this morning of choir and bells. I'm glad that we were able to do this in the midst of the situation we're in right now, but we're still doing as best we are able. I just have a couple of announcements so we can get started right away. One, the main one has to do with Christmas Eve service. We will be having a 4 p.m. and 7 p.m. Christmas Eve candlelight service here. And what we would invite you to do at the 4 p.m., if you come to that one, is please wear a mask and keep the mask on throughout the service. I know that's an inconvenience. I know it's difficult. But we want to make that service open to any who may have concerns about that, either health concerns or had not the ability to get a vaccination for whatever reason, chose not to, whatever it is. We wanted to have one service where those who have a greater concern could feel a little more comfortable. It's not easy to sing in a mask. I'll put my mask on and sing with you that way as well, but we do ask you to do that at the 4. The 7 p.m. is like it is today. We simply recommend a mask regardless of vaccination status. It also will be candlelight. There is a service on Sunday, even though that's right after Christmas, of course, and we will be celebrating the what is the day after Christmas, Sunday after Christmas during that time. During the next few weeks, we won't be having the Believe series study that goes on at 9 o'clock. That's being put on hiatus for a while through the holidays. And let me see if there was anything else I wanted to mention. Nope, that's enough. So anyway, we welcome you this morning. I want to welcome all of you who are listening on the radio or watching on the YouTube or on the public access TV. And just to remind you, today is the fourth Sunday in Advent, and the Sunday just prior to Christmas Eve service, we will have all of these services online as soon as we possibly can. As soon as after this service is possible, we'll have it available on both YouTube and on the website. The radio follows a week delay, as does public access TV. All right, so we're beginning here. We have this welcome up here, and I just want you to read it. We don't need to read it aloud, but just take a look at that and see what it is. It describes what we're going to be doing today, and then I'm going to be switching the slide to our call to worship, which is a singing of Emmanuel, Emmanuel. Thank you, and please be seated. This time we'll have the lighting of the Advent candles.
Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. The one who follows me will not walk in darkness, but have the light of life."
Mm-hmm.
We light these candles as a sign of the coming light of Christ. Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard.
Thank you. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, God with us. Today we pray that you will experience God's presence in a new and fresh way. We want to welcome his Spirit into our hearts and minds and feel God's comfort and the power of his presence. We are waiting and we welcome you, Lord, with open arms. Fill us with your truth, your will, your way, your love. Give us patience and faith, knowing to hear our every prayer.
Turn now to a time of prayer. I have a few joys and concerns to share with you. Angel Rolich shared a couple with me. Somewhere out there is Amanda Warwick. Where are you? There she is, visiting us from California. Hello, sitting next to Angel. Good to see you. Hope you brought all that warm weather with you from that part of the country. We could use a little now. Also, Angel shared a concern. Her grandparents had a house fire this last week. So keep them in your prayers if you would, please. We want to also keep in our prayers Jeannie Bernard, Karen Bork, and Lynn Wieborg, who are all being treated for cancer. So we want to keep them in our prayers as well, which was shared this morning. And then I would ask that you keep in your prayers as going into this holiday season and throughout the end of this year and in the next, all of the folks that work in our medical facilities around this country. Including right here in Door County. If you read in the Pulse, as I did the story recently, you saw that the ICUs are full, in fact, over full. They don't have very many there. The hospital's at or beyond capacity at various times over these last few weeks. And needless to say, that has caused us difficulty in treating other issues that come along. But also in the story, it indicated that we don't have that many doctors or nurses in our county, or in that, certainly in our community, to handle the kind of strain that is on the hospital system. So do pray for them. We never know when we're going to need them ourselves, and they're there for us, come what may, and doing the very best they can. But let us support them with our prayers and thoughts as we are in this period of pandemic. We're simply just not done with this yet. Pray for the end soon, as I am, and I know you are too. I also would ask that you pray for all of those who are traveling during this season, this next week. There'll be lots of folks on the roads and in the airplanes and all over, trains, as they travel for the holiday season. So pray for their safety, not only from this dreaded disease, it really is what it is, but also for their safety as they go forth to their families' homes, including my family, and I'm sure most of, if not all of yours. Let us pray. Merciful God, we pray to you this day as a community of faith. We open our hearts to you about those things that are of deepest concern to us, but also those things that bring us joy in life. It is the small things oftentimes that turn out to be the most important to us as we look back in our life, those small things that seemed at the time to be just not a big deal, but later in our lives we saw how important they were to us, how they gave us a sense of who we are. It reminded us of whose we are, and that we're a part of something wonderful in life. But so too are the needs that are on our hearts. They also are part of our life. So we lift before you those that have been mentioned. And we ask that you also, Lord, receive those prayers that are of our hearts that we have not spoken of this morning, but hold in our own hearts, that we lift before you as well. So whether we are joyful in our thoughts or have concerns or worries or whatever it might be, we give it all to you, God, with the assurance that you hear our prayers. You respond to our prayers in that way which is best, that we don't always understand, but that we know we can trust you. So we lift these before you and offer our thanks, even as we pray the prayer our Lord Jesus Christ has taught us himself. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As I've mentioned in the past, we don't pass an offering plate anymore. We have a box back there marked for donation or for offerings. We hope that you'll make use of that. There are envelopes in that as well as in the pews if you choose to do so. And we're coming up on the end of our year. You should, or if you're a member of this church or a friend, you probably received a letter from me with a Christmas offering envelope in it. I hope that you'll make use of it. But I want to take this moment just to offer our thanks for all the care you've given this church in this past year as we're coming towards the end of it. and helping us to finish this year strong. So we're very grateful for that, and I would like to offer a prayer of thanks. May we pray. Heavenly Father, we not only ask your blessing on the gifts given this church, and surely we do this, and every Sunday we do, that you'll guide us in our usage of these funds, that we will use them for the glory of your Son and yourself and the Holy Spirit, that people will come to know and understand what it means to be disciples of our Lord better because of our efforts here, and also for the work of the church that we do in the area of missions as we try to reach out in community, state, nation, and world in service in ways that we can, whether it be financial support or hands-on or both. We thank you, God, for your blessing that you guide us in these things and help us to make the right choices. But we also want to offer our gratitude, God, for the people who care about the future of this church, this community of faith, its mission in this area, in conjunction with all the other churches that are here. We are together one people of your Son, Jesus Christ. Though we divide ourselves for reasons that are seemingly rather foolish when we look at it from the big picture, we still do so, but we are united in this. We're united in the fact that you are our God. There is one Lord, one baptism, and one faith. So we thank you, God, and offer gratitude for the care and giving of not only financial gifts to this church in this past year, but also the many gifts of those who have offered their presence, their gifts of singing and playing music and being a part of the life of this church in worship, but also those who have gone out into the community and with their hands have done good for others. For all of this, we are truly thankful. In Jesus' most holy name, amen.
Morning. Today's gospel reading is from Luke 1, chapters 39 through 45, the Good News translation. This is when Mary visits Elizabeth. Soon afterward, Mary got ready and hurried off to a town in the hill country of Judea. She went into Zechariah's house and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby moved within her. Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and said in a loud voice, "You are the most blessed of all women, and blessed is the child you will bear. Why should this great thing happen to me, that my Lord's mother comes to visit me? For as soon as I heard your greeting, the baby within me jumped with gladness. How happy you are to believe that the Lord's message to you will come true."
We have all felt the frustration, pressure, sadness, and heartache of the past year and a half. However, while we wait, the Spirit of God is stirring. There is hope and joy coming, the babe in the manger. Fear not, as God told Zechariah, God hears our prayers. There will be peace on earth, for the Lord is with us. Yes, the angels are making their rounds. Glory to God.
as Luke tells the story. The angel Gabriel visited a priest doing his duty in the temple one day, a priest who was older in age, who was married to a woman named Elizabeth, who had desired this couple to have children all of their married lives and never were able to. The angel came to this priest and said to Zechariah, "You and your wife will give birth to a son." Zechariah said, "How can that be?" Well, turns out Elizabeth did conceive. She was in about her ninth month, and that's where the reading that we have today picks it up. Now, Elizabeth and Mary are thought to have been cousins, but the story of an angel visiting a priest in the temple would have spread far and wide, and particularly if you are a kinsperson, you would have known the story. Luke places this shortly after the same angel Gabriel had visited Mary and said, "You shall conceive a child. You shall conceive the Savior of the world." And immediately after that, she with haste goes to see Elizabeth. That's her first place to go, really, as Luke tells it. So when she gets there, and we don't really know where that city is, where Elizabeth and Zechariah lived, just know it's in the hill country of Judea. Nobody knows for sure where that was, for sure, at least not yet. When Mary gets there and greets Elizabeth, Elizabeth is overcome with joy. And literally, as we read the scripture and as people have studied this, breaks out in song. We hear it read, but the way that it is written, the way it is presented in scripture, Elizabeth sings with joy. And Mary's response is also believed to have been sung, overcome by her own joy. Now, I don't pretend to understand how two women in the first century, both pregnant during a time where there is great difficulty in childbirth, and so many died, not only giving birth, but children as well, that they wait till their eighth day of life to even name them. And I don't presume to understand what it would be like to, you know, face this kind of meeting where the two of you have experienced the Word of God directly in your lives, speaking to something that is incredible. But I know what joy is. I even know what it means to feel so joyful that you want to break out in song. Music is so important to our understanding of our faith and who we are. Overcome with joy. So I ask us today as we read this. Now, you know, Mary, I just consider something. She stays there for 3 months. Why would she do that? She was there for everything. She was there for the child's birth. She was there for the remarkable occurrence on the eighth day of the child John's life when it came to the naming ceremony. And it's the tradition for the father to give the name, but he couldn't speak. He'd lost the ability to speak from the time the angel Gabriel had announced John's birth to that very moment. And it isn't until Elizabeth says, "His name shall be John," that he got his power to speak that speech back. Mary was there for that. Mary was there to see the fulfillment of the prophecy of God, the fulfillment of the word of the angel. Imagine what that meant to her as she made her way back to Nazareth. Can we be overcome with joy with the birth of a child 2,000 years ago? Can we be overcome with joy when we consider what his birth means to all of humanity? Perhaps this Christmas season, this Christmas Eve, this Christmas day, we might find ourselves feeling overcome with joy Perhaps we may even feel the urge to break out in song. May God make it so. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Did you know that "do not be afraid" is the most often repeated command in all of Scripture? Luke 2, 10 and 11 says, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy. For there is born to you this day a Savior who is Christ the Lord." I do hope and pray that our music has brought you joy today. In spite of the weariness and difficulties of these past months, there is hope, joy, love, and peace. That is what these 4 weeks of preparation for Christmas have been all about. And yes, hope, joy, love, and peace was born through that tiny babe that laid in a manger over 2,000 years ago. But someone must show the world the way. That is us, my dear friends. We can show the world the way when we let God's love shine in our lives. To have that light, we must allow the Lord Jesus to be born in us and have a very, very personal relationship with him. Listen carefully to the words of our last song for the morning. Thank you.
just take a moment while we're standing to thank Elaine Diller, our choir director, and Ellen Betcher, our musicians for today, and our vocal and bell choir for a beautiful performance. May we also show our appreciation to them. Thank you so very much. They've helped us a lot with Know How to Sing now on Christmas Eve, so you got the songs down, so we're going to sing out, aren't we? And now, may the God of peace go with you. May God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you and keep you, my friends, as we come to this holy night very shortly, where we celebrate the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. May we remember that what was born into the world that day is the very reason we can stand here today with thanksgiving and gratitude for the salvation that we receive from the gift of our God, which is his grace to bestow upon all humanity. The very love that was born that night lives in us. May we live it in this day and the days that follow. May we show that love to everyone this season, that we know who our Lord is. In his name, be blessed. Go in peace. Amen.